Those of you
who may be guests here this morning, Pastor will be doing a first-person sermon.
He will be coming
to be in character.
And so the context for this morning's message
found in Luke
chapter 22,
verse 3.
Mike. Yeah. Turn your other one off.
Got it. Context for this morning's message is found in Luke chapter 22, verse 3. Then Satan entered Judas, called Iscariot, one of the 12.
Well, I see you've come this morning. You're all dressed up. You're what you call the worship of the Lord. And most of you don't have a clue that I'm sure to see what's going on here.
You kind of believe in a literal Satan, and yet you really don't either.
I've got most of you so fooled that I don't even exist at all, but let me tell you, I exist. I'm here every chance that I can. When you meet, I want to be here. Most of you, I'm not really real, but I am real. I am a personality, and I am very powerful. But you know what? I want you to think that I am a figment of your imagination. And if I can continue to make you not believe in me, I've won. So therefore, to most of you, you kind of believe there is a literal Satan, but not really. Just like the one you say, you've come here to worship today, and you say that he has a master plan. Well, let me tell you, I don't want you to know that I too have a master plan. And if you knew my master plan, it would literally scare you. I have a plan, but most of you in the church, I'm not real. And if you don't think I'm real, then I can get by with some things that I could never get by with otherwise. I am real. I am a personality. I am a fact.
Yes.
And that ought to scare you to death. I have you disbelieving in me in two different ways. One way I call the cartoon character. And my cartoon character is this. I want you to think that I run around with red leotards on. I want you to think I got a pointed tail and a little horn. I want you to believe that. I want you to think I've got a pitchfork just waiting for somebody to bend over. And if I can get you believing that, I have won a great victory. But if I manifested myself as I really am, you would see that I am beautiful. The Bible that you never read says a lot about me and who I am and where I have come from and that God created me. Your Bible tells you about me, even though most of you don't read one. You carry one. You carry it piously, and you want everybody to see you got a Bible, but I see you. You don't read it. You don't look at it. And I love that. I love that you don't read your Bible. So you just take whatever the preacher says as truth instead of verifying it in his word. You know what I'm talking about? And that is good for me, for if you read what the Bible says,
I can Ecclesiastes, Ezekiel, and Ezekiel 28:12, and it tells you something about me. The Son of Man, take up a letter concerning the King of Tyre and say to him, this is what the Sovereign Lord says. You were the model of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone adorned you. I have been exalted until that day I made a dreadful, awful mistake. Now, if I don't get you believing that I'm a cartoon character, I got a plan too. Plan two is this. I want you to think that I am confined. I want you to think that I am in hell and I am there all day long shoveling coal into a furnace, making it hotter and hotter for those that are there. I want you to believe that I'm confined. So if I can't convince you that I'm a cartoon character, then I want to convince you that I'm confined to a particular place. But I want you to know, I don't want you to know that I am alive and well at Vansville Baptist Church. I am a personality and I have a position. The Bible says also, you are anointed as a guardian cherub, for so I ordained you. You were on the holy mountain of God, Mount of God. You walked among the fiery stones. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created. If you ever read your Bible, you would know these things about me, but I'm so glad that you do not read your Bible. It's a blessing for me when you come to church and you sit there and you look in your little iPads and you look in your phones and you look in these things and you miss what the preacher says. I love that. I love when you're texting someone else out of the church somehow and you miss what the preacher says. I love that. I strive on that. Yes. And it makes my day. I see you sleeping. I see you writing notes. I see those things, and I'll even whisper in your ear. You know what? The food on the stove is burning. If he doesn't get through soon, you're going to be behind the Methodist at the restaurant. Isaiah chapter 14 tells you more about me. In verse 12 it says, how you have fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn. You have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. Here is my problem. I have a problem. You may not think that this is my problem. You may think you know my problem, but I have a problem, and the problem I have is the same problem that many of you have also. It says in your Bible, you said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the Mount of Assembly, on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. Let's go read that just yet. You see my problem. I have an I will problem. I say I will ascend my throne above God. I will do this and I will do that. And I exalt in myself.
choice whether to put him that you say you've come to worship up here, or you put yourself up there. I don't want you to put me up there, because when you put yourself up there, you're putting me up there. Just don't put him up there. Many of you have an I will problem. I will do all I can to keep you uncommitted. And I will do everything I can for you to exalt yourself. See, you can say I will enthrone God or I will enthrone myself. See, even angels have a choice. And many of us decided that we were more powerful than God. It was a mistake that I made. I have forgotten how powerful God actually was. But you are brought down to the grave, to the depths of the pit. We got thinking how we could overthrow God. We had our little huddles and our little meetings, and we thought to ourselves, well, we can overthrow God. We forgot how powerful God is. And it didn't work. Revelation chapter 12 tells you more about me and how I was kicked out of heaven, if you ever read it. But let me tell you this, even though I was kicked out of heaven, I still retain much of my power. I still have power. I still have lots of power. Not like I used to, but let me tell you, I am a B.I. Your Bible calls me the prince of this world. Your Bible calls me the prince of this world. I still retain a lot of power. Ephesians 6:12 tells you something else about me. For our struggle is not against your struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. That's me. Your struggles are against me. And I'm here to make your struggles as hard as possible.
That's true.
That reminds me of the time I tempted the one you say you've come to worship. Now, I used a threefold plan to tempt him. It didn't work on him, but boy, it works on you. You fall for it just about every time. First, I called phase one, lust of the flesh. After he had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, he became hungry. And I said to him, if you really are the Son of God, turn this stone into bread. If you really are, prove to me who you really are. Turn this stone into bread. He was hungry, and he could have done so. He wanted to walk where you walk, but you don't want to walk where he walks. Then he used scripture on me, and whatever it was, he said. Second is what I call the pride of life. I took the one you came to worship, and I took him up to a high pinnacle of the temple, and I said, looky here. Look at all this stuff. If you really are the Son of God, throw yourself down, and the angels will swoop down and save you, and everybody will be Then again, he pulled out some scripture, whatever it was. If that does not work, and it didn't on him,
I call my final phase there the lust of the eye. I took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and all their glory, and I said, I'll give you the world if you'll fall down and just worship me. All you got to do is fall down and worship me, and I'll give you the world. He didn't do it.
That's right.
He didn't do it.
Amen.
Then he said something about worshiping God and only God or something. But now let me bring something to your attention. The one you came to worship never said it wasn't mine to give. He didn't take it, but he never said it's not yours to give. I have power. Power, power, power in high places. Who do you think gave power to Hitler? Who do you think gave power to Hussein? I still giggle somewhat when people ask, when Kennedy was killed, was that a conspiracy? Let me tell you, it was a conspiracy. And I orchestrated it.
Yes.
Yes, it was most definitely a conspiracy. And 9/11, people said it was a terrorist attack. Yes, it was. It most definitely was a terrorist attack. And I'm still in the game of terrorists. Think badness. You don't know my purpose. It is very simple. First, I want to possess the unbeliever. Oh, let me tell you this morning. Now hear me. I don't want you to hear me. You don't have to join an occult. You don't have to go out and parade on the streets and say you don't believe in God. You don't have to do that. Just don't worship Him. And I got you. See, you often think if I join a cult, then I'm going to hell. Just don't join Him.
That's right.
And you're going to hell.
That's right.
And I'll be looking forward to seeing you. You know what? People who think they are in the church and they're only in the local church. I love that group. I'm on a church roll. You are. Well, you know what? I go to church. I'm glad you do. But have you committed your life to, you know, that one that you say you come to worship? Because if you haven't, I'll answer.
That's right.
I don't care that you come to church. I don't care. It's when you're committed to Him that I care.
True.
Second, I want to oppress and suppress the Christian. I can't have you as a Christian. Greater is He that lives in you than. But I can influence you. I can get you to compromise a little here and a little there. You know what? He won't mind if you compromise a little bit. It'll be all right. He's such a loving, caring God that He doesn't mind if you steal a little here or you fudge on your taxes here or you do this. Oh, and if I can influence you as a Christian or oppress you as a Christian, convincing you that nobody, this is a good part I like, nobody wants to hear about Him. I love that. I'll get in your ear. Nobody wants to hear about Him. you, because you know what we hate more than anything else? We hate rejection. So therefore, you won't talk about him because you're afraid that someone will reject you. And if they reject that word, they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting him, and that's good news for them. I want to get you thinking about what God won't let you have instead of what he lets you have. I want you to think about it. I want to tell you, well, God won't let you have this, or God won't let you have that, instead of all the things he does. Oh, let me tell you, my plan works today as well as it worked on Eve. Let me tell you, I just get excited about my plan and how well it worked on Eve. I just smile how well it worked on Eve. Your Bible has something to say about this. No, man, it was good. Genesis chapter 3, it says, now the serpent, guess who that is? The serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. See, the one you came to worship said, I am a murderer and a liar, and he was absolutely right. I am going to murder and I'm going to lie, to murder and murder, to lie every chance I get. That is my goal. The motive is to murder and my method is to lie. Notice, isn't this good? Listen to what I said to Eve. The woman said to the serpent. That's what I said there. I said to the woman, did God really say? Did God really say you must not eat of any tree in the garden? That's not what God said, but that's what I told her. Did God really say, I got her doubting. Did God really say, don't eat from any of the trees in the garden? Is that what he really said? I got Eve thinking negative about God. Then the woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. At that moment, I had Eve. Notice what I said to Eve. You will not surely die. The serpent said to the woman, Eve, you're not really going to die. God created you. He's not going to let you die. It's all going to be fine. Just take of the fruit. Eat it. It'll be good. At that moment, Eve began to question God, questioning God's punishment. I am so glad that you don't know God does not send anyone to hell. Listen, I hear people go, God sent so-and-so to hell. No, he didn't. God sent no one to hell. If somebody goes to hell, it's their own fault.
Amen.
And you know what? I don't send anyone to hell, but I sure will urge you and push you in that direction. Every chance I get, I want to shove you a little bit in that direction. Oh, I had Eve going. Maybe some of you saw the movie Ghost some long years ago. The best part of the show was when the man dies and some of my cohorts drug him screaming into hell. And the movie theater was and there were we laughing. I like it when your religion gets in the way of your salvation. I have churches setting aside teaching of Scripture. And you know what they're going to? Literature, they're going to poems, and they're going to all kinds of other things instead of staying with the Word of God, and I love them. Oh, I love it when churches will take hymns and take the blood out of their hymn books. Yeah, that is disgusting. Back to our story, verse 5. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. Listen, there are those that say, well, you know what? Adam and Eve fell down. That was not their problem. They wanted to fall up. They wanted to be like God. They wanted to fall up, not fall down. I'm glad you don't know it, but I am defeated. I'm glad you don't know that I'm frustrated. Your Bible that you don't read tells you more about that in Revelation. Tells you how to overcome me. Revelation 12:11, the first part says, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb.
Amen.
I was deceived by God. I didn't understand. I thought that I had put him on the cross. I worked through the high priest, and I worked through the Romans, and I worked through these individuals to put him on the cross. I was deceived by God. I didn't understand. At the tomb, I saw him buried. We, as a group of demons, followed the body to the grave, and he was dead. And they rolled a stone in front of the tomb, and he was dead. And we partied for 3 days. We partied. Then came that dreaded day. Early Sunday morning, the ground began to shake. I told my cohorts, we better get the heaven out of here because all of heaven was about to break loose. Second part of that says, and by the word of their testimony. When you confess his name in my direction, I can't stand it. I have to leave. I don't like it. When you confess his name in front of me, I can't handle it. It's more than I can handle. Next is, they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Most Christians have this take it or leave it attitude. Most Christians have this take it or leave it attitude. When it's convenient, I'll take it. When it's not, I won't. So uncommitted, let me tell you, I'm going to keep you uncommitted as long as I can. So don't talk to me about your commitment to him. I know what your commitment is to him, and most of it's not very committed. As long as something else doesn't come along, you're committed. I see it. I am thankful the church as a whole is uncommitted. I'll tell you a story. You wasn't there, but I was. Caesar decided that he wanted to take this little island. He had already taken everything else. The island wasn't worth having. Small group of peaceful individuals lived on this island. But Caesar decided he wanted this little island. Well, the island was full of peace. But they saw the big ships coming. Caesar's emblems all over their ships, they began, this little group of people on the island began to take their shovels and hoes and all these instruments of producing food, and they began to carve them into some type of whip. Wow. You know what happened? Next, Caesar's troops came up in a boat, bringing their ships to the harbor. And they unloaded all these weapons of war off the ships onto the land. Now these peaceful people got a line across. And they thought, we're going to defend our island. And you know what Caesar's men did about it? They took the ships and they set them on fire. And they pushed them out into the water and washed them. And when the ships had burned and sank, Caesar's men turned towards these peaceful, loving men and women of the island. You know what they were saying? Caesar's men were simply saying this: we will live or die. Girl.